Divine Truth Assistance Group. These group assistance sessions are about putting principles of divine truth into action. This discussion is part of the 2014 Australia Group 2 series. Mary presents Challenging Addictions, filmed on the 31st of July 2014 in Monkerai, New South Wales, Australia. This is part 2.
All right. Let's go back to challenging addictions. Who remembers the first three aspects of challenging addictions that I've already mentioned? Kel?
Be willing to feel my overwhelm. Allow myself to feel my overwhelm emotions.
Yes, so that's what I talked about in the introduction when I was talking about the things we're going to have to work through in order to get to the point where we're even willing to emotionally challenge our addiction. So there was three things, wasn't there? Our lack of faith, our fear of emotional overwhelm, and our resistance to truth. Yep. Then I talked about the fact that we're going to have to go through this intellectual deconstruction process that Jesus talked about when it comes to our addictions. Then we're going to have to go through the emotional process of deconstruction of our addictions, which is the fun bit. That's when change has the possibility of happening. And the aspects the key things that I've been talking to you about already on the PowerPoint are some of the elements of that emotional deconstruction process. So everything I've mentioned so far, we need to embrace emotionally. Can you guys remember the three things that I mentioned already that we're going to have to do? Anto?
Feel emotionally that the addiction exists and that it is a sin?
Yes, yes. Very important. And remember I said that's some of the biggest work in starting. This is where our will power starts to shift into a will to love. When we really want to feel the sin emotionally. What was the next thing? Jules? Next to you, sweetie. Yeah.
To take the responsibility that it's yours and your emotion and it's up to you.
That's a big part of acknowledging the addiction, that we're responsible for it. It's ours. What did I talk about next? So we're noticing the addiction. And remember I said you've got to get in touch, really getting to know these emotions, all these things emotionally. So the second thing I mentioned was we have to notice the emotional response and feel it. Do you remember? So notice, first aspect, we're feeling the compulsion part of it and starting to become sensitive to it as a sin. The law of compensation, we're saying, yes, God, I want to feel that I've been shutting down all this time. And in amongst that, we're also going to want to feel, oh, how do I feel when this gets met? How do I feel when it doesn't get met? We're really going to want to feel those emotions. And remember I said when we're more sensitive to the sin, what we once thought was a really, what did Karina say earlier today? All your Christmases have come at once, kind of a feeling, bloody wonderful, starts to feel a bit like, oh, you know, I want to like it, but it feels a bit yucky now. Yeah. So that's the second element of this first phase. I'm calling it this first phase as we're starting to engage our will to love a little bit around addictions. Ella, you have the third one?
I've tried right now during lunch to notice everything that was happening.
Yep.
I assumed that pretty much everything was an addiction, so I tried to pay attention. And actually, I got a couple of them met, a couple of them I resisted.
Uh-huh.
And actually, what I felt that the pleasure of meeting an addiction is clearly a lot more superficial. It's really a very slight pleasure, although it's intense, but it doesn't go really deep. That's what I felt about it.
Yeah, yeah. So great. You already started on your homework that Cornelius gave you. Now, what's the third thing that I said we need to do in this process? I'll give you a clue. It's on the PowerPoint. Glenda.
Don't judge.
Don't judge. And what did we say about judging? That in itself is another addiction. And it actually causes us to ignore the addiction that we're starting to say we want to challenge. And this is where a lot of us fall down. Remember, I said the first place we fall down is noticing it but not wanting to feel the sin. The next place I see a lot of people fall down is we notice it, we feel it's a bit icky, but then we just want to go straight into judgment in order to avoid really connecting to what's going on. We just punish ourselves a bit and let ourselves off the hook. Okay, next part of this process is where the fun starts. This is where we don't feed the addiction. Now, I want to talk to you about this step because who feels like they've already done this step? Identified an addiction and not fed it. Yeah? Yeah? I said, no, no, no. There was a hand there, no, no. Look, come on. Don't you feel like you've heard a lot about divine truth and then you've gone, oh, no, I'm not going to do it? Gwenda?
On an intellectual level, yes. But from a soul basis, no.
No, yeah. And this is what I want to talk to you about, this step in really challenging your addiction emotionally. If you've gotten this far emotionally, if you've worked through the intellectual stuff, you've begun to feel it as a sin, and your will is engaged in the desire to really let go of it or challenge it or at least expose what's going on here, you are going to not feed the addiction, not because you want to be a good girl or a good boy, not because it's a huge effort of willpower, but because you really want to expose the emotion that's driving the compulsion. You want to know it now. You're like, no, stuff this. I've got an intellectual idea of what's going on, but now I just really want to know what's the feeling I'm trying to avoid. So this is a powerful part in this process of challenging addictions. So we don't feed the addiction. It's like that, isn't it? Like feeding a hungry monster sometimes. It's insatiable. So let's not feed it. Instead, stop satisfying the addiction and it will expose the emotion driving it. Only if your will is involved in this. If your willpower is involved, it's unlikely you're going to expose the emotion because the will is still saying, I don't want to know, I don't want to know. Does that make sense to everyone? Yep. Okay. There we go. It's not an act of willpower. So we want to find what the addiction is covering. And you might choose to do it in lots of different ways. If you identify, wow, I've got this compulsion with men and I'm always doing this thing, you might find that, okay, right, well, here's more men, I'm not going to do that. And actually, I know that there's a party happening, there's going to be a whole heap of men there. I'm just going to go there just so I can discover more about this addiction and uncover more of this emotion that I've been trying to avoid. So you might actually even seek out ways to trigger the addiction. And at this point also, you might get involved in doing a bit of like emotional research, can we call it? So, okay, I've got this issue with men. You know what? I'm going to read that book about men and I'm going to watch that movie that's all about men and I want to find it now. You're suddenly this will that before has been like, no way, I want this compulsion is paramount. What did Cornelius call it? The pain train. I'm staying on the pain train. All of a sudden you're like, show me the next station. I'm off this train and I'm going to find a different way. Okay. So you might even seek out confrontation of your addiction to discover more about your emotions. Okay, so far, any questions? So what's going to happen next? Oh, the suspense. I'll tell you. You're going to have to emotionally feel the addiction itself. This compulsion is driven by a whole heap of feelings of entitlement, that this is fine. This compulsion is a really reasonable thing to have. That's what you feel. when you're entrenched in it. It's driven by feelings, false beliefs. No, people should just be nice to me. That's love. All of these kinds of things are driving our addiction. And before we're actually going to get to expose the emotion we've been avoiding through using the addiction, we're going to have to feel through some of this addiction itself. So let's get some more information about that. Ren, you had a question? Whoops.
Renee. So this is the difference between when Jesus was talking before about a lot of women in the room only feeling the demand that the addiction's not met, and when Jesus was talking to mental blank,
Justin.
This is more about feeling the tantrum.
Yes, you might feel some tantrum in here, and this I want to talk to you more about this, okay? So let's put up a bit more of the slide. In fact, let's put up all the slide, and then I'll talk a lot about this because, there we go. So, a lot of this happens. Can you see when you're in this cycle of addiction? When your addiction is not meant, you feel a lot of these words that we put up here this morning. Sometimes it's a tantrum, angry, injustice, unloved, rebellion, no, it's not fair, panic, all these things, okay? Now, usually in that place, you still want to hold on to all of those beliefs. There's no emotional challenge yet. You feel perfectly vindicated in whatever response you're having. Make sense? And this is what leads you to feel justified in continuing in the compulsion. However, if you've already engaged this process that we've been talking about emotionally so far, and you've noticed the addiction and you've wanted to be sensitive to the sin, now something different can happen. If your will is engaged to love and uncover the emotion, you're still going to have to go through a lot of these feelings of the tantrum. It's not fair. You're going to have to let go of some of your false beliefs, remembering that all beliefs are emotional. But throughout that process, you will be much softer to the experience, realizing, this is my error leaving me. I feel like this, but it's totally, I can see now. There's a shift in you emotionally, so it's not an intellectual thought. You can go, this is the pain of not getting what I want because I feel like I should be able to get it. But I recognize now that's a sin. And so it is like a tantrum, but it's more of a self-responsible tantrum. Does that make sense? You're just going through the emotions, but you're not projecting outwards anymore that this is someone else's problem or someone else's responsibility. Saying, feeling emotionally, this is my responsibility, and man, it hurts not to get what I want. I've been feeling like for 35 years I could get that thing. But I feel now I can't, but I'm just going to have to go through the pain of this, of not getting my expectation met. Does that make sense? So this is a lot about the facade having a bit of a fight. The facade's been justifying this all this time. And now you're cracking through some of your facade by releasing these things. Yep. Got me? Any other questions on that one? It's a really important step. And a lot of people want to jump out of that because it feels really uncomfortable. Kadira?
I'm not sure if this question just quite relates to this, but it's about addictions that you might have had in the past. Like I used to smoke 40 years ago.
Yep.
And I gave it up, but it took me 3 months to stop having an after-dinner cigarette. And do I still have to go back and release emotions that were related to that then, or would I transferred the emotions around the reason why I smoked to some other addiction?
Yes, most likely. If you didn't go through an emotional process giving up the cigarettes, or you didn't feel some, like a sort of a will-based change around the cigarettes, it was all willpower, it's very likely, well, as you're rightly feeling right now, the emotion you were wanting to suppress still is within you. You just substituted a different addiction.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. This is where, also in this step, this is where I see a lot of people sort of almost inadvertently get to. Suddenly all their addictions aren't getting met, and they start to feel things like, oh, nobody loves me. Like a partner breaks up with them and they start going into, oh, nobody loves me. I'm, you know, it's terrible. And calling that crying causal emotion. When actually they are crying, their crying is driven by a false belief, a belief that is not truthful. And all of our causal releases happen around truth, like truthful events and truthful feelings. And this is where my partner not hurting me is hurting me by not doing exactly what I want. They're not loving me. Now, a lot of that is based around falsehood. And just to use Justin's example again from this afternoon, sorry, Justin, but you can you see that? Like where a lot of your feelings now of not being loved, it's based on expectations that and false beliefs you were given in your childhood. And you're going to have to go through the pain of releasing them in releasing your addictions, but you're not yet at the causal feelings. It's just freeing you up, if you like, to get to the next step, which is, you ready to move on, everyone? Yeah. So the next step is when your hurt self feelings begin to emerge. And this is good, isn't it? Now you're getting down to the proper feeling that's been driving this compulsion all this time. So some of these feelings are going to have been suppressed in your childhood, and so they'll feel quite childlike, like I talked about yesterday in the talk. And some of them are going to be from your adult years. And this is the point when the addiction can leave us. When we get to this step, now we're starting to change the level of compulsion in our life. Anto?
So is every addiction, every feeling that you feel in relation to one addiction associated with a feeling of hurt? Or can you have multiple addictions relating to the same hurt feeling? Oh, so you only get a degree of... Because I get confused sometimes.
Okay. All addictions are related to the avoidance of hurt, definitely. But sometimes you can have multiple addictions to help you avoid the one hurt. Or one addiction to help you avoid multiple hurts.
Permutations.
Is that all right?
Too many permutations.
Yeah. Yeah, something about the soul is that it's very logical and rational, but when we get in there and mix it up with injury, you know, it's very hard to put... We are... What's the word I want to say? We're very adaptive in the way that we want to avoid pain, which is sad, isn't it? Because that's the product of our will, just wanting to avoid pain. But so we find very, very many ways to do it. But the good thing is... And so when you get to this point, it's relieving, you know. You're going to feel relieved. And we'll go on to the further steps anyway once you... and hopefully that gives you a bit more clarity as well. Ange, did you have a question? Oh, you're scratching. Okay. Cool. All right, well, let's move on to the next slide. And this is really magic, hey? Obviously, I'm really enthused about it because I just started doing it. You might not find it magic, but now there comes increased awareness. So when you get to that point where you've challenged this addiction emotionally enough that you start to feel the hurt self's feelings that you've been suppressing with the addiction, now it's suddenly like light bulbs come on everywhere and you have a huge new awareness of how pervasive this addiction actually is. And you realize, wow, actually there's more to this than I thought. I've got more work to do. But it's actually a good feeling because you begin to feel the truth of what's been happening in lots of different areas of your life. So can everyone read that? It's a bit small. It says, as we engage this process sincerely, we naturally become more sensitive to the price of the addiction. And while we might think now that we get how much this addiction is affecting our life, trust me, when you get to the hurt feelings and have more sensitivity to it, you realize, oh, it's much bigger than I thought. And you begin to become more sensitive to the sin, which is great, because this fuels your motivation to keep going. And remember when I said we're sensitive to the sin, it's not in a self-punishing, crappy way. It's like, oh no, I want to love. And now it's uncomfortable for me to feel how out of harmony with love I am. Marco?
Marco, does that mean that you constantly need to sort of, you know, get into the addiction to bring up all the emotion and the hurt? Like, you know, when you're getting more involved in your emotions,
yeah,
and you want to keep triggering it,
yep,
sort of, and then it stops, do you reapply yourself again? How do you do
yes.
that?
Yes, well, and we're going to talk about that okay. next. You'll actually go through this process again and again. But remember, when I'm talking about this, you're not engaging the action of the addiction. Now you're engaging sensitivity to the emotions around the addiction. The challenge is happening emotionally, and you're actually not meeting the addiction because you want to feel more about it. But you're very right, and the final thing we'll talk about is the fact that you re-engage this again and again. Okay, so the increased awareness, in that we recognize how pervasive the addiction is in our life, what other elements there are to the addiction, and this is some of the things Anto that we're referring to. You know, we might realize, oh, there's a bunch of hurts I've been trying to cover with this addiction, or, oh, now that I connect to this hurt, I can see I use those three other addictions to avoid this feeling. How the addiction is affecting our life and the life of those around us. The actions that we previously viewed as harmless or loving, which we now see are sinful. Does that make sense? So we get more sensitive to this addiction and how it's operating and the hurt we're trying to avoid, and suddenly we realize, oh, wow, just when I thought I was helping out that person, I was actually meeting an addiction. Or actually, what I thought was love, what Mum and Dad taught me was love, now I can see that's all about placating fear or whatever it is. We have more linked addictive behaviour in our life, so we see more of the behaviour that's linked to this hurt that we previously were avoiding, and further possible emotional causes for our behaviour, for our addictive behaviour. And this is where we might even engage again the deconstruction process from an intellectual perspective again, or just in this emotional phase again. Once you start connecting to your hurt self, that intellectual process speeds up a lot more. Okay, we experience increased sensitivity to all of our addictions, actually. We have increased sensitivity to the harm we've caused to ourselves and others through addiction. We have increased sensitivity to fear, grief, and our hurt self. Catherine?
Our addictions are covering our hurt self. Now, is it a bit like other things? When you get older and older, you keep on making another addiction because it's still hurting. And
yes.
So instead of having one or two addictions, you could have 25 on one small thing?
Yeah, because remember, all of God's laws are operating all of our life to try and expose truth to us. Truth about ourselves, truth about the universe. And if we're carrying a hurt and suppressing it, God's trying all of our life to expose, hey, that's not helping you. Hey, there's a truth you're avoiding. Hey, and if our will is engaged in suppressing that, we're going to have to employ more and more and more techniques to keep it at bay.
Yes, so we
create another addiction.
So create another addiction. But the good thing is when you get to the hurt, you'll find it easier to let go of multiple addictions.
Thank you.
The problem when we live in fear and when we live in avoidance of our pain for a long time is that we are reinforcing false beliefs to ourselves. You know, we're saying this lack of faith feeling that I talked about in the beginning compounds. But once you start to turn that ship around, you work through some of that lack of faith, things begin to loosen up. So you've already started to engage that process, my sister. All right. Okay. So this is the bit where we revisit until it's done. So we've gotten this increased sensitivity. We recognize now, wow, we also feel a bit more esteem in ourselves because we've noticed sin. We've decided we don't want to live in it. We don't want to act in the compulsion anymore. Instead, we want to expose the emotion. So we've actually gone through this process. We've felt some of the emotion. We've felt the addiction loosen in our lives. And we have new sensitivity to the sin that's still in our lives. And now we actually feel more motivated to do that whole process again. So we revisit until we've cleared that addiction. So in order to be free of addictions, we'll have to repeat the process of challenging the addiction multiple times. We'll uncover more emotions that have been driving the addiction. And this increased sensitivity that we've been talking about makes us more likely to repeat the process, as I just said. Yeah. And to stop feeding the addiction. So the good part about what I've been sharing with you is that once you engage this process even once of emotionally challenging an addiction, you get more motivated to do it again because you have more confidence that you can do it. You recognize there's rewards for not feeding the addiction. Remember Cornelius said, we believe this big lie. We believe this big cycle of compulsion. We believe that that's the truth of how the world operates and how we're ever going to get happiness. Once we challenge it once and go down this other path, we realize, oh no, there's a whole other way things could be. And I feel better about myself engaging it that way. Okay, any questions? Dan?
Daniel, I'm not sure it's really a question, but I find I get stuck. The whole time you're talking, I'm comparing my physical addictions in my life.
Yep.
And taking that step to acknowledging emotional or other addictions is I'm finding really challenging.
Yep.
I'm sure I can go away and work on it. But I'm wondering if you have any tips or did you start with physical addictions with this? Because the cycle of addiction model really, I get so much. I even feel it for my physical addictions. But
yep. But for emotional addictions, you don't feel sensitive?
Maybe
to
a couple,
much.
But those
yep.
examples don't come yep. to mind really
yep.
easily.
Yep.
I feel like my physical addictions are my biggest and that's not the truth.
No, not at all. Yeah. Not at all. In fact, when you start engaging with challenging emotional addictions, you'll find your physical addictions fall away like effortlessly.
So it'd be better to focus and find the
yes.
emotional ones.
Yeah. Yes, yes. And I would start, Daniel, by wanting to educate yourself about the sin, you know, exploring some of the things that Cornelius talked about, the feelings, the codependence feelings that you feel in your relationship and wanting to, you know, having that desire for truth about those things will help you get more sensitive to the addictions.
Yep.
And, of course, notice the compulsions, notice your anger. When you get angry, there's an addiction didn't get met. So, okay, what was just going on right then?
Yeah,
you know,
I do know some of them where they're emotional, just as you said that.
Yep.
Some of them are relationship related and not getting my needs from Phoebe. Yeah.
Sorry, not getting.
Not getting needs from Phoebe.
Yeah. So not getting what you
emotional
want.
Emotional needs, yeah.
Yep.
And it's like you said, when the anger comes up, it's because an addiction hasn't been met. And
Yes, so that's a great, and you have the benefit of being in a relationship, and so there's a lot of constant interaction, and you can notice, you can help each other even with this.
Yeah.
One of the magic things is if you can get to a place in your relationship where you actually, you want to care for the hurt self in the other person, and you want to assist each other in the challenge of addiction. So when someone else, you know, when you notice you get angry, you go, oh, hang on, this is me and my addiction. And your partner says, it's so it is. Let's find out what it is. What's my part in it, you know? And then you can start to really grow and have that. Remember yesterday Jesus said that relationships based on facade aren't really real from God's perspective anyway. And it's only when you get closer to your real self that you'll be able to really have a love connection. So, yeah, starting in your relationship with the things that make you angry is a great place to start.
Yep. Thank you, Mary. That's great.
Yeah. Says,
Mary, is it ever possible that just facing the, it's a physical addiction, removing the addiction and, or, you know, gradually becoming more aware of it, that that something can change fairly quickly? Not saying that the emotion has been fully dealt with at all, but that there's, like, that something can change quite quickly?
I think when you connect to your hurt self, a lot of things change quite quickly. But before then, you've got to be careful you haven't just substituted another addiction. Like, if you stop a physical addiction and then you don't feel some pain, some, if you don't start feeling some of these things, then you've subbed in a different addiction.
Yes, but that period of feeling that compulsion, like, I just really want that and I'm not going to let myself have it.
Yeah.
But then that feeling of desperate compulsion can pass, and it's like, I know that feels so horrible to do that. But
yep. The only way you can be certain that you've released the addiction is if you have connected to the hurt underneath that compulsion feeling. And you'll know if you've done that. So I think your question indicates that you have distracted yourself from your compulsion. Do you concur, Jesus? Yes. Yeah. This is the hurt self, the connection and release of feelings from the hurt self is the thing that obliterates the compulsion. Nothing else.
So it's only when you, yep. Yeah, so that would be kidding myself to think, oh, it's not anywhere near as strong as it was.
Yeah, because honestly, you've just so psyched yourself into a place where it's not such a big deal, and it's willpower surrounding this compulsion. And there's a lot of compulsions that are still left in your life that can fill the gaps. Kel?
Yeah, just on from that, that's what I've been doing, like stopping coffee, going shopping, doing little things like that, and actually noticing myself get more angry and putting that on to Bruce.
Yes.
And so, I sort of in a bit of a lull about that I've given this up and I've challenged an addiction, and then it comes out somewhere else.
Yeah. So you're not getting and how sad is it that you're willing to give up these physical addictions and still there's so much coming out of you towards the person who's supposed to be the most special to you, the anger of not getting those addictions met ends up getting placed onto your partner.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because I was still not using my will to feel my hurt self.
Yeah. If you try to give up the compulsion using willpower,
yeah,
it's going to be so hard. You're going to end up being a tetchy, miserable, kind of cranky person.
Yeah.
And you're better off examining your will as it is without facade. This is why we emphasize the facade is so important to let go of. Like, let yourself see how you really are right now.
It doesn't matter.
No, Jesus wants to engage you anyway. So, Kate, hold on to the mic. Yeah.
Yeah, when you give up your addiction through willpower, it's a bit like a smoker who gives up his cigarettes by force, right, by force of will. But everybody knows that a smoker who does that gets what? He gets really grumpy, angry, bitter, twisted for 3 or 4 or 5 weeks, particularly the initial part. He's really twisted, right?
And then what does he do generally? He goes and gets candy or some other form of addiction to suppress this this other thing that's even worse for him, is what he believes. But he does that because he hasn't dealt with the hurt emotion. And Mary's statement, many of you just dismissed. She made a statement that said, if you do not get to the hurt emotion, you will not give up the compulsion. You will not. All you're doing is using willpower to get around it, or you'll take on another addiction to avoid it and then say, oh, I gave that up years ago. But when the actual feeling, the hurt feeling, is still not released. Remember, Mary said in this list, the point of doing the whole thing is to get to the hurt feeling that creates the compulsion. So that's our point. Like, unless you get to the hurt feeling creating the compulsion, nothing will actually be benefited through the rest of the process. You must get to the hurt feeling and fully feel the hurt feeling associated with the compulsion. Otherwise, there will be no benefit to the rest of the process. Mm. Yep.
Thanks, honey. Yep. And this is about, remember my first talk this week, I talked about the will to love. This is a lot about engaging that will. The overwhelming stimuli, you know, placing yourself in situations where you would usually just live in addiction and choosing to expose the emotion or not meet the addiction and feel the feelings. This is a lot about growing your will to love. Remember I said I didn't even start growing my will to love again in this life until I started to do this properly. Okay. Let's see what I wrote in conclusion. Okay. Addictions will not leave us unless we challenge them emotionally. Anything else, intellectual work, is all going to be based around willpower. Many people have been attempting to deal with their addictions based on willpower. Can you guys relate to that? Like, I tried that for a long time and it just gets demoralizing, because you're just having to use more and more will. And that more and more willpower, and your will is already engaged in trying to get the addiction met. So it's like an internal battle going on all the time. Willpower can never be effective because the addiction comes from emotions. And remember, will is what is the emotional soul-based desire. Willpower is the attempt to override the will. So to truly release addictions, we must engage an emotional process. So everything I talked about with you today, acknowledging the addiction, that's going to be an emotional thing, not an intellectual thing. You'll feel it like, wow, oh, I can feel that addiction in play now. Feeling the responses, you're going to engage with that with a knowledge emotionally of the sin. Not judging yourself will be a will-based decision. And then feeling through the addiction and feeling the hurt self, that's all going to be emotional. And the good news is when you get to that point of feeling the hurt self, the addictions do naturally leave you. And actually, what felt like a huge big thing and a huge effort for years and years and trying to stop it and fix it, you think, oh, what was the big deal? I don't even feel like that anymore. Things become easier, you feel more relaxed. Because actually this, I think Cornelius mentioned that earlier today, this takes up a lot of energy and effort, being engaged in this process all the time. It's like you think, how did I ever get anything done when I was so engaged in just in this compulsion of avoiding these emotions? Like, when did I have any time left for anything else? Because you notice how much energy it was taking up in you, and suddenly you feel like a lot lighter. Okay, any questions before I give you your homework? Yes, John?
John, what do you do if you're totally clueless about any addictions that you have in your relationship?
In your relationship?
Yeah.
I would probably give the same advice that I gave to Daniel and Phoebe. I would notice when there's anger in your relationship, there's a sign that an addiction is not getting met? No anger. Then you're going to have to start the intellectual deconstruction process. Examine, do we feel close? Do we feel close all of the time? You do? Oh gosh, you guys are perfect. Yeah, no anger, feeling close. You probably don't have any addictions. Do you think that's
true? That's what I'm worried about.
Do you feel you're growing closer together every day, that there's truth all of the time in your relationship? Yes? Oh, well, I don't know then. I think that you're going to have to... Yeah, Jesus.
Yeah, usually a person... you're not at one with God yet, right? You know that. So the fact is that if you're not at one with God yet and you're very, very happy in your relationship, there's a very highly likelihood that you're both meeting each other's addictions to the maximum possible degree and that you both believe it's right. Mm. Now, dealing with an emotionally codependent relationship where you both agree with each other is one of the most difficult things you're ever going to have to do in your life, to be honest.
Thanks.
Because
it was much nicer when I answered, wasn't it? Yeah. Oh, you're fine.
because you're already feeding almost everything and each of you are in agreement with what the other person's feeding you and with what you are feeding the other person. So that means the fact that you're both in agreement means that it's going to be very hard for you both to actually see what you're actually doing. And this is the kind of relationship that is very hard to work your way through and grow in, because both of you will be resistive to growth in along looking at the addictions. Both of you will have the same amount of resistance, and both of you will have the same amount of resistance in the same areas. Now, there's one other thing Mary said. She said, look at your anger. The reality is both of you do have slight annoyances that occur in your relationship, all right? And a slight annoyance is anger. So maybe we should say anything from a tiny little slight annoyance or irritation, you know, so you both have irritations in the relationship, just little irritation, just little thing, you know, like the way they do something, the way they say something, whatever. Then those kind of issues usually cover big issues in a relationship where both parties are in total agreement all the time. Right, so that's where I would start. And I would say to myself, I'm not at one with God yet. So the fact that we feel we're at one with each other already means that we must be in a lot of codependent addictions. Now, the key, once you start opening yourself to that concept and praying about what they are, you'll find God will quickly show you. Mm. So if you have a sincere desire to know, God will quickly show you. And then you'll also be able to start to identify, oh, yes, I have that little slight irritation all my life with my wife, and I've just skipped over it or ignored it like I always do. And I've become so used to ignoring it that I don't even think I just think it's a normal part of my life now. And you'll start identifying those things first probably. But there'll be a lot. There'll be a lot and it will be very difficult. What we've found when we've observed relationships, myself and Mary, the ones that have the most difficulty in growing towards God who are in a relationship are the people who already believe their relationship is perfectly ideal. Mm-hmm. They're the ones who have the most difficulty because there's no desire in either party of the relationship to actually start looking at what's really going on in the relationship. So this is going to require some really sincere desire to start examining. And the trigger for it needs to be your desire for a relationship with God. See, that's what helps me continue going. So I'm always thinking, well, even if my relationship with Mary feels ideal, right, if I know I'm not at one with God yet, I know I must have addictions. And so what I do then is I focus on what those addictions will be. And once I've started identifying, I then realize, this is also affecting my relationship with Mary, even though I wasn't aware of that before. Yeah.
I just have one other idea. Which is because, as Jesus pointed out, you're in codependence, so you're sharing a lot of common beliefs about what love is and what's right thing to do. So something just to begin as an intellectual process would be to start a list and divide your page in two. And this is something that Jesus helped me with in the past, but in a singular fashion. But at the top of one side, you could put our belief. And on the other side, God's truth on the matter. And then start listing your beliefs. So, for example, a lot of couples share the belief that a man's role is to placate a woman's fear and a woman's role is to help the man feel good about himself, worth. So if both of you share that belief, you'll have perfect harmony in your relationship. But it's very different from God's truth, which is that women were born capable to experience their fear and men's sense of worth should not be dependent on the women in their life, just for example. So you can start with your belief, this is how we feel men and women should behave together, but God's truth is this, This is where we're going to have to start some work in prayer and examining, do we really want to be in harmony with God or with each other? Because being in harmony with each other in error is always going to keep us away from God. Does that help, honey?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Anything else? Yep, here.
Hold the mic closer.
Yeah.
Hold the microphone closer. And you hold it right up close like that.
Have you got any suggestions for those of us that live alone?
Yes. Those of you who live alone, my suggestion is that you are very blocked to your soulmate and you have a strong desire for control. So I would start looking at my attachments to control in my life. And I'm probably speaking to, babe, yep.
Yeah, I would add to that, you are very angry. You are very angry with relationships because you've become that angry about relationships that you no longer want one. So you're willing to sacrifice even any love whatsoever in order, because you're so afraid of a relationship and very angry about having one. So I would have a look at where the other angry areas of your life are and start examining those because they will tell you where the addictions are.
Yep.
But if you're honest with yourself and you're not in a relationship, you must be very angry. And many of you admit that you are, if you think about it. You know, I am sick of those kind of relationships. I'm never going to have another relationship. And, in fact, you've actually said that today.
With a lot of anger. Yeah.
With a lot of anger. Yeah. So that tells you that you're very angry, and whenever you're very angry, it means that you've got a very big addiction that wasn't met.
Yeah. So I think the anger is a good place for everyone to start. Remember, this is usually the response when our addiction doesn't get met. So anywhere that you have anger in your life, just go, okay, right, what's the addiction that's not getting met? What's the false belief I have where I feel justified in getting something that I didn't get? Because that's going to be something that I'm going to have to deconstruct.
And the previous thing you said, Mary, about drawing the table, the reason why I've encouraged Mary, and I've done that myself, is because this helps you identify your own personal beliefs and even what your intellectual knowledge is about what God's beliefs are. And if you can compare the two, you will see great discrepancies between your belief and God's belief. Now, everywhere there's a great big discrepancy between your truth and God's truth, there will also be a great big addiction.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Yeah. No worries. Yeah. Okay. Well, let's look at your homework because it's somewhere along these lines. So the first part of your homework is the journal exercise. So challenging your addictions is necessary if you're going to progress. It makes sense, doesn't it? Our hurt self we're totally avoiding through addictions. Unless we challenge the addictions and begin to remove them, we're not going to get in touch with our hurt self. You can see now how facade and addictions are really related, hey? So the first part of your homework is to examine why, what are the reasons you aren't engaging the challenge of your addictions every day in multiple areas already? Why hasn't that already started happening? So you're going to be thinking about things like how your will is actually engaged, or things like your lack of faith, or the lack of desire for overwhelm, or resistance to truth. I just don't want to know. I didn't see it. Or I don't know what it's going to be for you. So, but why haven't you already started to, given that you've all got some quite extensive intellectual knowledge about addictions by now, why hasn't this process already begun for you? And remember, with all of the homework that we're giving to you throughout the week, this is an opportunity for personal self-reflection. There's no right or wrong answer. It's going to be unique, your answer, to you. And it's designed to help you find out more about yourself. Okay, second part of your homework. Second part of the journal exercise. What are the emotional reasons why you are justifying not engaging the emotional challenge of your addictions right now? So we're not doing it, so we've got to be justifying it in some way. What's the justification you have? And the final part of your homework, the final, like I say it like it's a little thing, is to challenge at least one addiction using the described techniques that I talked about today. Someone who's not writing down their homework can help me recap the different things involved in challenging your addiction emotionally? What were the things we talked about throughout the talk? Nobody knows, or everyone's writing. Nick, you want to have a go?
First, develop an intellectual awareness.
Yes.
Of the issues involved.
Yes.
Next is to then start cultivating an emotional awareness.
Yes.
Of the issues involved.
And the key element of that being what I had up on the board, the emotional awareness of the sin.
The sin, yes.
Yes.
Yeah, yeah.
Yep.
So we start to connect with the icky feelings of it.
Mm-hmm.
And then the next step is to challenge the addiction.
Yeah, well, so first we're going to get to know the emotional responses. We're going to want to feel them, actually, mm-hmm. rather than feeling them a little bit and going away from it. We're going to want to feel them. And then we're going to remember that judging is just another addiction. So we'll avoid the judgment, yep, and self-punishment, yep, go ahead.
Yep. And then the challenge.
Yes.
Yep.
Then we allow ourselves
to feel the emotions that arise when we challenge it.
Yep. So we stop feeding the addiction, and then we're going to feel the addiction itself, like stop feeding the big monster, and then we start to feel the big monster, which is all these false beliefs and all these justifications and all of these, no, I want to get it, oh, but I can't because I can feel it's a sin, you know, that kind of process. And then we have the opportunity to experience some of the hurt feelings. And when we do, this is when the addiction can start to leave us.
Yeah. And in feeling all of those feelings that arise when we challenge the addiction, there has to be the desire to feel the underlying hurt, otherwise we won't get to it.
Very key. We're going to stop feeding the addiction because we desire to expose the emotion underneath. So when you guys have this as a homework task, I feel I'm asking you, encouraging you to engage it emotionally. So if you only get to the first step, acknowledge the addiction is a sin, feel it as a sin, you've started some important work. If you go about just willpowering, trying to not do the addiction, but you have absolutely no desire to expose what's really going on, it's pointless. So I'm encouraging you, engage it emotionally from a soul-based perspective. And if you don't feel in that space yet, start intellectual. Educate yourself about the sin. What is this sin really, you know, how am I really sinning? What intellectual information can I gather about that even to help me become sensitive emotionally to it? Cool.
I would just emphasize that trying to do any of this with willpower is a path of absolute destruction.
Speaking from experience.
Speaking from experience.
Yeah. Thanks, Nick. Okay. Sound all right? Let's see if my fancy slideshow, I've just gotten into using this slideshow, has anything else? Okay, so write about what you discover when you try to challenge an addiction emotionally. Write about that in your journal. Okay. Ken, you had a question? Just wanted to see the slide again? Okay, sorry. There we go. If you give me the all clear when it's okay to move on. Now, in a few days, we're going to have the opportunity possibly, depending on how our timetable's going, to discuss some of what you discovered in your homework together. My last slides are about... Hiroko, you had a question? Yep.
I can feel all all of my addictions and acknowledge that what I've done, and then go in a panic, and then I go in fearful space.
Just need to hold it closer.
Okay, I went straight into the fear. It's still addiction to be in fear.
Yeah, what you call feeling fear, Hiroko, is often very addictive.
It's
a way of avoiding interaction with people. It's a way of just avoiding being present often. Yeah. You get that sort of panicky thing going on, and that's not actually feeling the fear that's driving your addiction.
It's addiction.
That's another addiction.
Another one.
Yes. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank
okay. You. All right. Just behind you. Yep. Okay, I'm just going to go through the final couple of slides because they're just some ideas for you, different areas where you might want to challenge addictions. And then I'll go back to our homework slide. So interpersonal relationships. This is a huge area, muddied with addictions. So you can change the way you communicate and relate to other people. If you're addicted to facade and avoidance, this means that you will have to make contact with others and be honest and open. If you're addicted to control and domination in interpersonal relationships or interactions, then you'll be quieter and listen more and focus on ethical issues. Miranda?
Sometimes you have to. I mean, I feel like I have both of them.
Yes.
Yeah.
So
in some areas that I'm confident, then I feel, you know, dominant and superior, and the other ones I would avoid. And
yes. Yeah. So how would you engage with this homework then?
Well, exactly that, what it says there.
Challenge yourself in the opposite ways.
Yeah.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yep.
Thank you.
Okay. Another area, eating and drinking habits and personal comforts. I notice you guys have a fair few addictions in these areas. Just observing a few things around the place the last few days. So you could recognize and challenge an addiction in that area. Your eating habits. Lots of us eat for comfort. Some of us are very strict about what we eat. Nick has been challenging himself in that area heaps this last few days. Very, very awesome. Yeah. Okay, another area is technology. Ah, this era's favourite addiction. Karina?
Sorry, but because it applies to me, that last slide was too quick. I couldn't.
Okay. You don't necessarily have to copy all this stuff down, guys. It's just giving you some ideas about where you might want to challenge up yourself.
And those of you who have already got a copy of the latest material from us, you'll find that this PowerPoint presentation is on that material.
On the hard disk drive.
Along with the homework. Yeah.
So if you have your technology with you, you can plug it in. Okay. We're ready for the next slide? Yep. Technology. So you could recognize and challenge an addiction in that area. In our last group, somebody just stayed off Facebook for a couple of days and had a very intense response. You find that there's a lot of emotions underneath your addictions to technology. Because it's so instantly gratifying, a lot of us tend towards technological addictions these days, if we have the means. And so we've gotten very comfortable with avoiding a lot of emotions through technology. Okay. Well, that's it from me, guys. Do you want me to go back to the original homework slide? Did everyone get it? Yes, okay. Whoops. No, I've just gone.